Telemiddags 14:38 met een uitzending voor vandaag, 13 oktober 2018, is het bulletin van zaterdag. The major part of this broadcast is in English, but we will first start with some info and news in Dutch. De uitzending van vandaag is grotendeels in het Engels, maar we beginnen vandaag met informatie en twee nieuwsberichten in het Nederlands. Vandaag geen data, maar wel een SSTV-plaatje in PT90, anderhalf minuut lang dus, helemaal aan het eind, naar Lodewijk. Ik ben met name benieuwd hoe dat via de microfoon gaat als je via dmr.li luistert. Staat het beeld dan recht of niet? Het niet goed uitgelijnd zijn kan te maken hebben met de autoslant-instelling van programma's. Uit de autoslant moet namelijk aanstaan, auto S-L-A-N-T. Daarnaast kan het nog een kwestie zijn van het niet gekalibreerd zijn van je geluidskaart. Bij meerdere SSTV-programma's, bijvoorbeeld bij QSSTV, is het mogelijk om met een routine de timing van de geluidskaart te kalibreren. Dit kalibreren kan behoorlijk wat tijd in beslag nemen, dus doe dat niet terwijl de uitzending nog loopt. PD90 dus, aan het eind. Ja, zoals ik zei, twee nieuwsberichten. In Ierland is sinds kort het DMR-netwerk verbonden met Echolink. Het Ierse netwerk blijft groeien met telkens meer stations die een DMR-idee aanvragen. Ook komen er steeds nieuwe repeaters bij. Daarnaast is er een groeiende belangstelling voor System Fusion. Via de node MI0AAZ-L kun je sinds kort vanaf Echolink naar talkgroep 2724 op het Ierse netwerk. Tegelijkertijd is de Echolink-node ook verbonden aan WirusX Room CQIRL nummer 41411, ISF 04251 en verder aan het analoge Allstar-netwerk nummer 29884. Er zijn daarnaast nog twee vergelijkbare koppelingen in Ierland. Eentje tussen DMR en D-Star en Fusion. En eentje tussen DMR, Allstar, D-Star en Fusion. Dit bericht komt uit meerdere bronnen. De Franse plaats Saint-Malo in Bretagne profileert zich voor de toeristenindustrie als een radioamateurdorp. In de plaats is een radiomuseum dat de historie en evolutie van radioontvangers laat zien. In het museum laten zendamateurs uit de regio aan bezoekers zien hoe ontvangers werken, vanaf de vroegste modellen tot aan de meest recente ontwikkelingen en dat alles op een didactische manier. De apparatuur die gedemonstreerd wordt betreft zowel radio's voor omroep als voorbeelden van professionele apparatuur, ook zoals bijvoorbeeld gebruikt tussen 1939 en 1945. Daarnaast worden er videopresentaties gegeven. Ook dit bericht komt uit meerdere bronnen. Vandaag in het Engels het nieuws van de ARRL en daarnaast de column van Onno VK6FLAB.
This is ARRL Audio News, your weekly summary of news highlights from the world of amateur radio.
I'm Carla Pereira, KC1HSX, and these are our stories for Friday, October 12th. Amateur radio public service volunteers were active when Hurricane Michael made landfall near Mexico Beach on the Florida Panhandle on Wednesday. The Hurricane Watch Net became active Wednesday morning on 20 and 40 meters. WX4NHC, the amateur radio station at the National Hurricane Center, had been receiving observed weather information and data from amateurs and passing it along to forecasters. The VOIP Hurricane Net was involved as well to support communication with the National Hurricane Center. The Southern Territory Salvation Army Team Emergency Radio Network had been handling emergency, priority, and health and welfare traffic from impacted areas, providing ground truth information from amateur radio stations and other sources in the impacted areas for forwarding to Salvation Army leadership. Saturn had been requested to provide amateur radio operators for Pensacola, Panama City, Tallahassee, and Tampa, as well as 2 to 3 local units in Georgia and divisional headquarters in Atlanta. The ARRL North Florida and West Central Florida sections assisted Saturn with additional operators in Pensacola, Panama City, Tallahassee, and Tampa. Thanks to ARRL efforts on Capitol Hill, language in the 2018 Federal Aviation Administration Reauthorization Act, just signed by the President, resolves the issue of problematic or preclusive rules affecting some rural amateur radio towers. The previous FAA Reauthorization Act of 2016 had instructed the FAA to enact tower marking requirements similar to those in some state statutes, aimed at improving aircraft safety in the vicinity of meteorological evaluation towers. Those towers are typically between 50 and 200 feet and set up in rural areas, often on short notice. In the wake of fatal crop dusting aircraft collisions with METs, the National Transportation Safety Board, or NTSB, had recommended that states institute laws, sometimes called crop duster statutes, requiring markings and registration of METs. While some state crop duster laws exempted ham radio towers, federal regulations dating to the 1996 FAA Reauthorization Act did not, and ARRL had expressed its concerns since. Prior to 2017, unless short radio towers were located within the glide slope of airports or heliports, they were not required to be painted or lighted. After attempting to address the issue through the FAA, the ARRL's legislative team met with staff members of Senator Jim Inhofe of Oklahoma and other lawmakers and their staffs associated with the congressional committees of jurisdiction. Senator Inhofe, himself a pilot, was of the view that the 2016 legislation was excessive and that exemptions should exist for both broadcast and amateur radio antennas and support structures. Members of the Winona, Minnesota Amateur Radio Club provided communication support in mid-September for 300 riders taking part in the Ride the Ridges bicycle tour. Members patrolled four routes, ranging from 23 to 105 miles, as well as seven rest stops, working voice communication via a UHF repeater near Winona and the Riverland Amateur Radio Club VHF repeater 30 miles away in Wisconsin. APRS was used to track support vehicles and also offered messaging capability. As a public awareness effort, a large screen display at the ride's start and end showed friends and family the progress of riders. With cell coverage impaired by the terrain, the club installed two temporary digipeaters to assure constant contact with the APRS units.
I'm Steve Ford, WB8IMY, and I'm speaking with Bart Yonke, W9JJ, the ARRL Radio Sport Manager. And Bart, how is September doing with the International Grid Chase?
Hey, Steve. We just wrapped up our tallies for September. We reached the 10th of the month a couple of days ago, and we've gotten some good tallies, still having strong activity in the International Grid Chase, and got a few numbers for you.
Okay.
To begin, overall, activity was down, about 15%. This is not a complete surprise as we get into September and into the fall months with changes in propagation, mainly affecting our medium bands. I saw a little bump in the low band propagation, again, with less solar absorption. Increases in activity from 630 meters to 30 meters, in other words, the very bottom of our allocations up to 30 meters. That was up about 10%. And the activity between 2 meters and 3 centimeters was up about 25% between activities like September VHF contest, some of our 10 gigahertz contesting activities, and even activity coming out of Europe is always strong in the VHF bands, and they do a lot of logbook reporting.
I'm curious about 630 meters. What sort of activity was going on there?
You know, Steve, the counts are still low, at least those being reported to Logbook of the World. We had about 17 reported contacts during the month of September, obviously not a significant amount to report on. Most of those were digital contacts, but nevertheless, still solid, still happening. We had about 13 contacts during the month of August.
This is still a difficult time to work 630 meters, still a lot of thunderstorms running around. And
it
everything.
Is.
So, yeah.
And I mean, both of our lowest bands still waiting for a focused increase in activity, but 630, of course, people are on, as compared to, say, 160 meters, where there was over 2,700 reported contacts during the
really?
Month of September.
That's excellent for that time of the year.
It is, including 75 of them on phone. So people were still battling out the static crashes.
Okay, very good. Thank you, Bart.
Thanks, Steve.
And now with this week's satellite update, here's Bruce Page, KK5DO.
If you happen to enjoy rare DX or grid chasing on the satellites, we have a few good ones in operation or starting in the near future. Members of Radio Club de Panama and GREMPA will be operational on the satellites as 3 Echo 1 Juliet Tango through October 31st. QSL via HP1 ALX. Wayne and M3B will be operating from Cure Beach, North Carolina in FM 13, an almost all wet grid from October 13th through the 19th. VY0 ERC, the Eureka Amateur Radio Club, will operate from Echo Romeo 60 and Echo Quebec 79 from October 17th through November 10th on FM satellites. For more information on upcoming GRID or DXCC trips, visit amsat.org and click on Satellite Info. There you will find the link, Upcoming Satellite Operations. This is Bruce Page, KK5DO, for the ARRL Audio News.
I'm Steve Ford, WB8IMY, and this is the ARRL Audio News Propagation Forecast for Friday, October 12th. The sun remains blank, and the solar flux index remains pretty low as well. Even so, don't completely ignore the higher HF bands. The ionosphere could be unpredictable, as hams learned last weekend when 10 meters suddenly burst wide open for some long-haul contacts. Take time to send some CQs on digital, CW, or voice. After all, if no one calls, no one answers. We have solar particles on the way that will probably arrive Sunday or Monday to cause some disruptions, but nothing intense is in the forecast at this time. On VHF and UHF, things have been relatively quiet, with the exception of the southeast. The weather surrounding Hurricane Michael is triggering some tropo openings on 2 meters, and these are anticipated to continue for the next few days.
And that concludes ARRL Audio News for this week. Our thanks to all contributors to this week's report. ARRL Audio News is produced by the American Radio Relay League, the National Association for Amateur Radio. For more information on amateur radio or the ARRL, visit us on the web at arrl.org. You can also find us on Facebook and Twitter by searching for ARRL. If you have a question or comment about ARRL Audio News, email us at audionews@arrl.org. This program is copyright ARRL, all rights reserved. 73, and thanks for listening.
I'm Ono of the Foundations of Amateur Radio podcast in Australia, and you're listening to the Daily Minutes by Papa Alpha Zero Echo Tango Echo. Foundations of Amateur Radio. The other day I did an experiment. I searched for dipole calculator, and using the first 20 results, I calculated the length of a dipole suitable for 7.130 MHz. I chose the frequency for no other reason that there is a 7130 DXNet every Monday, Wednesday and Friday, and for the longest time I've been unable to participate due to the lack of a HF antenna in my new shack. So here's some things I learned from doing this experiment. Depending on which calculator I use, the length of my dipole can vary by over a meter from longest to shortest result. Depending on my desire to use metric or imperial measurements, my dipole will be a different length, because of course electrons move at a different speed if you're not using the metric system. In case you're wondering, 1 inch is defined as being exactly 2.54 centimeters, so there's plenty of opportunity to vary that. Speaking of standards, we all agree that the speed of light is a constant, right? Turns out that for some calculators you can change the speed of light. I'll skip over the notion that none of the calculators actually show what they're using as the speed of light and move on to other interesting discoveries. Apparently, you can determine the length of a dipole down to the subatomic length, with one calculator going down to the size of an electron to indicate how much wire you should cut from a spool. There are forms that make doing the calculation really easy. Single box to type in the frequency, so the answer must be right. There are some that use random standard numbers, even a textbook example that uses some number, but no indication where it comes from. For example, the number 486 features regularly, but so does 150 and 5905. There are forms that provide you with several boxes, but no indication which box needs what value, so your answer may or may not indicate the number of eggs per chicken per parsec. One dipole calculator result is actually for a vertical, so your search engine helping you might not actually give you the calculator you expect. There are percentage correction factors. 5% seems to be a favourite number, but no indication as to what the origin of that number is. There's a calculator that allows you to specify the feed point impedance. Not sure how that works, but it's a nice feature to have when you're calculating the length of your dipole. Not. One regular instruction is to cut long, that is, measure your wire and cut it longer than the calculator states. How much longer is left as an exercise to the reader. Should it be 1 millimeter longer, 1 centimeter longer, Or should it be 1 meter longer, and how much should that change if the frequency changes? Let's move on. The word ground features heavily in these calculators. The phrase average ground does too. No indication as to what makes an average ground or how to go about determining what changes if your ground isn't average. We all agree that the dipole should be half a wavelength above the ground, right? How much is that? The same wavelength as the length of the dipole we've just calculated, or a different one? How does the length of the dipole vary if the height varies? While we're looking at variation, how much variation is there depending on how thick the wire you're using is? And what about insulation? None of those things are even mentioned in any of these calculators. Dipole calculators. Wonderful invention. Shame about the implementation. I'm Ono, Victor Kilo 6, Foxtrot Lima Alpha Bravo.
Do you suffer from the heartbreak of brain rot, feeling bored, sluggish, listless, not had a new idea in days, using electronic gizmos without a clue why they work? Now there's help. Ham radio, guaranteed to stimulate your corroding neurons and open a whole new world of excitement.
Side effects of ham radio usage include mental stimulation, desire for education, new career paths, understanding of technology, and cases of addiction have been reported. If you experience any of these symptoms, you're welcome.
Ham radio, it's not your granddaddy's radio anymore.
Daily Minutes zijn dagelijks vanaf ongeveer 1900 uur te beluisteren. De uitzending wordt een dag later om 10:30 ochtends herhaald. Alle mail is welkom op het adres x@xdv.me. Dat is ook te vinden rechts bovenaan de webpagina van de uitzendingen www.pa0ete.nl. De Daily Minutes toont iedere dag weer aan de hand van schokkende voorbeelden hoe een hobby mensenlevens kan veranderen. De internetfaciliteiten en studiohardware voor Daily Minutes worden gesponsord door 70MHzShop.nl. 70MHzShop.nl.
En microfoon naar retour.